Hachette Audio presents The Art of X-Ray Reading. How the secrets of 25 great works of literature will improve your writing. Written by Roy Peter Clark. Read by Jefferson Mays. To my brothers, Vincent Clark and Ted Clark, for their tender care of our mom, Shirley Clark, who at age 95 was still singing. Introduction. Where writers learn their best moves. Where do writers learn their best moves? They learn them from a technique I call X-ray reading. They read for information, or vicarious experience, or pleasure, as we all do. But in their reading, they see something more. It's as if they had a third eye, or a pair of X-ray glasses like the ones advertised years ago in comic books. This special vision allows them to see beneath the surface of the text. There they observe the machinery of making meaning invisible to the rest of us. Through a form of reverse engineering, a good phrase used by scholar Steven Pinker, they see the moving parts, the strategies that create the effects we experience from the page, effects such as clarity, suspense, humor, epiphany, and pain. These working parts are then stored in the writer's tool shed in boxes with names such as grammar, syntax, punctuation, spelling, semantics, etymology, poetics, and that big box, rhetoric. Let's get to work. Please put on your new X-ray reading glasses so we can examine the titles of a couple of famous literary works. The first is The Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock, 1915 by T.S. Eliot. The poet died in 1965, my senior year in high school, when I became the keyboard player in a rock band called T.S. and the Eliots. Prufrock is widely considered one of the great poems of the 20th century, and I encourage you to read it for the first time or again to see if my claims about the title ring true. The poem is, most of all, a poignant reflection on the losses brought on by aging. The protagonist is torn between the lingering longings of youth, romance, sexual energy, creativity, social prominence, and his sense of himself as an old man. He wonders if women at social gatherings discussing Michelangelo will notice him. He shrinks in stature and wears his pants rolled up at the cuffs. He worries whether his dentures will allow him to eat a peach. He looks back to see how his life has been measured out, a wonderful poetic phrase, and all he can see is coffee spoons. Those are the dramatic and thematic outlines of the poem, but how did Eliot create them? If we can answer that question, perhaps we can begin to know some of the things he knew as a writer. Maybe there will come a time when we can reach for that knowledge and write a title to a text that draws on the same creative energy used by Eliot. So, what is the source of that energy? My X-ray vision reveals that The Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock is a title built upon a tension, a friction, a rub between two dramatically different phrases, two radically different kinds of language. Write down some of the associations you make when you hear the phrase love song. My list contains courtship, romance, flirtation, beauty, serenade, youthful exuberance, hope, longing, music, poetry. The range of associations, writers call them connotations, can be wide. A Shakespeare sonnet is a love song. My love shall in my verse ever live young. But so is Double Shot of My Baby's Love by the Swingin' Medallions. So who is the persona created by Eliot to sing his love song? Does he have a poetic name such as Marvel, Wordsworth, or Longfellow? No, his name is J. Alfred Prufrock. Make a list of things that come to mind when you read or hear that name. My list includes banker, academic, attorney, businessman, bureaucrat. Nothing defies romance like a name that begins with the first initial followed by a full middle name. John A. Prufrock sounds more regular than J. Alfred Prufrock, which tiptoes near a parody of cold British fussiness. And then there is Prufrock, a name in full defiance of love song. Passion and fervor are neutralized by the empiricism of proof, anchored to the hardness of rock. Read another way, that last name might divide as prufrock, someone who wears prudish or prune-ish garb, a shrinking old man who wears his trousers rolled up so he won't step on them. The tension can be felt in the very letters. The first phrase, love song, hooks up the liquid consonant L with the sexy sibilance of S. In contrast, prufrock links a plosive P with the fricative K sound. Combined, the effect is like a great wave of sea and sand crashing onto a boulder-blocked shore. See what happens when you put on those X-ray glasses? You are cured of the myopia of common reading. Beyond clarity, you gain an inner vision of literary effects at its best psychedelic, kaleidoscopic, and 3D. You are beginning to see as a writer. Let's say you've learned that lesson, that a gifted writer may create a title in which two key elements collide. You now see titles in a new way. Another Nobel laureate, Thomas Mann, penned a novella entitled Tonio Kruger, published in 1903. This was one of the first stories I read in college under the tutelage of a brilliant young scholar named René Fortin. He also assigned prufrock as part of our required reading. He taught us how to pay special attention to moments of tension in a text. Such tension was easy to find in the character of Tonio Kruger, a young man torn between the influences of his German father and Italian mother. He imagines his life as an artist, a life of sensual creativity, the part he inherited from his mother. But he has elements of his father in him too, a German banker whose life, however dull, offers the promise of stability and financial security. I want you to feel that tension in Tonio Kruger, lectured Fortin. Feel that collision between the coldness of his northern European heritage and the heat from the Mediterranean south. It's there before your eyes, there before you read the first word of the story. We had no idea what he was talking about, but he was right. There it was in the title itself. Tonio Kruger. Italian versus German. Long, open vowels versus umlaut and hard consonants. An artist's first name versus a banker's last name. To my ears, Tonio has the sound of a romantic character in an Elizabethan play. Kruger sounds like a form of currency. X-ray reading not only gives you deeper reading knowledge, it also gives you a writer's knowledge. Think now of all the authors who have created titles, popular and literary, in which two elements don't feel as if they belong together. My favorites include Paradise Lost, The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn, The Catcher in the Rye, To Kill a Mockingbird, Leda and the Swan, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, The Postman Always Rings Twice, Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, The Great Gatsby. But to those classic works of literature, I would add popular ones such as the Harry Potter series. J.K. Rowling's powerful young wizard has an English king's nickname and a common tradesman's last name. How about popular reality shows such as Duck Dynasty and Amish Mafia? My favorite title, as you may know by now, is Buffy the Vampire Slayer, in which the savior of mankind, the one who defeats the forces of evil, is not a Conan or a Van Helsing, but a blonde teenage valley girl named Buffy. It is as odd a title as if Melville had made his famous whale purple and named it Moby Grape, actually the name of a 1960s San Francisco-based country rock band. Hey, I want to play. I heard that one of the top executives at Little Brown, my publisher, had been reluctant to publish my book on the elements of language, a sequel to Writing Tools, until he was dazzled by my title, The Glamour of Grammar. There you go again. What could be less glamorous than the common perception of grammar? And yet at one time in the history of English, they were the same word. As odd a combination as if T.S. Eliot had named his love song Tickle Me Elmo. The idea for this book was born during the summer of 2013 on the Long Island Railroad, because the new film version of the Great...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.